Okay, so I'll be talking about this topic, closed system enteral nutrition. Are we ready for the change? So this topic was asked to be presented during this nutrition conference in Ramaya Hospital on 23rd November 2019. So the main learning objectives of this talk is to look at whether we are ready to adopt this ready to hang or closed system enteral nutrition as a nutritional support for critically ill patients, and whether this stands the test of evidence-based medicine, and whether we could integrate this for our decision-making process. So that's our learning objectives. So the topics that I would be covering is the importance of enteral nutrition in critically ill patients who are admitted to ICU. And now the whole question whether we should consider the open system enteral nutrition versus the closed system enteral nutrition. So closed system is where you do not have to reconstitute the products before administering the nutrition, and the closed nutrition is commercial formulas. So the open system is where you reconstitute, or it could be even blenderized food from the kitchen, hospital kitchens. So the whole science is to decide which is better, whether blenderized diet is better. That is one aspect. The second thing is commercially available enteral nutrient solutions which are open based, where you reconstitute in the water on the patient bedside and then administer, or would you adopt this closed system where it is already reconstituted, where it is available as saline bottles like this, you just have to connect to the patient and start feeding them. So this is what we are going to deliberate on. And then we would just discuss briefly on choosing the right enteral nutrition formula, commercial versus non-commercial. So which is better? And whether this ready to hang or closed enteral nutrition, whether it has a bearing on improving outcome, whether there are any clinical studies on that. And use of closed enteral nutrition in home care, because in home care reconstituting is becomes sometimes difficult. So if you have ready to hang sort of a solution, it becomes much easier to comply with even at home care. And take home message. So I think the background of this is it has been found that 30 to 70% of the critically unwell patients in ICU have gut dysfunction. So, and because of their gut dysfunction, there is a significant compromise in the delivery of enteral nutrition in ICU. So any mechanically ventilated patients or critically unwell patients, it has been found they have some element of GI dysfunction. And it is being found that mechanically ventilated patients, 50% of them have GI dysfunction. And it is being found that in 74% of the patients fail to achieve 80% of the target nutrients in mechanically ventilated patients because of various reasons. And because of the pre-existing or the coexisting pre-morbid conditions like traumatic brain injury, sepsis, or any other life-threatening conditions that impair gut dysfunction as a part of the disease process, or any of these concomitant conditions like inflammatory conditions, sepsis, hypoperfusion, and all the drugs the patients would be on like sedatives, opioids, catecholamines. So all these have a bearing on gut dysfunction. So these are some of the elements which interfere with the gut harmony or gut functioning, and this interfere with the nutrient absorption and nutrient delivery. So the GI dysfunction, obviously what it leads to is malabsorption and intolerance of the feeds, and that leads to calorie and protein malnutrition. Because you have GI dysfunction, your absorption is limited. That's why your nutrient targets are not achieved, and then malnourishment may set in. And this has been found to increase your ICU mortality, increase the risk of infections, increase the ICU length of stay, and to some extent reduce their nutritional adequacy. So these are some of the references you have of gut dysfunction that sets in ICU and its bearing on all of this mortality, infection risk, ICU length of stay, and nutritional adequacy. So what is the relationship between nutritional intake and clinical outcome in critically ill patients? It has been found that in critically unwell patients, if there is energy deficit or calorie depth, so it has a direct bearing on adverse clinical outcome. So there was this big observational study done by Canadian group in 167 ICUs in 37 countries, where they looked at 2,772 mechanically ventilated patients who were being delivered 1034 kilocalories per day with 47 grams proteins per day. And they sort of collated the data on the type of nutrition that was being given, the quality of the nutrition that was being given for about 12 days. So they recorded in these ventilated patients the type of feeds that was given and the quality of the feeds for 12 days. And what interestingly they found, if you look at this curve, so they found the maximum benefit of good nutrition was happened in patients where BMI was less than 25. If you look, the mortality reduction was very dramatic in patients with BMI less than 25, or another extreme where BMI was more than 35. See, if you see, the mortality reduction was very significant in patient group with BMI more than 35 and in patients with less than 25. So what it means to say is, even if BMI is more, so there is a risk of them getting into malnourishment. So where nutritional needs have to be addressed. If you do not address, their mortality can really increase. So you can make a difference in mortality by optimizing nutrition in patients who are malnourished preemptively, or in patients with BMI more than 35. So what it means to say is, just because someone's BMI is high, it doesn't mean that they are nutritionally optimal. So you need to optimize nutrition even in them. So the conclusions they made from this Canadian study was, increased nutritional intake is needed, and it has been shown to have direct correlation for lowering mortality and increasing ventilatory free days, which is very good, in patients with BMI less than 25 or more than 35. So that's what they found in this big study from Canada. So I think this is quite intuitive for all our intensivists. So we do not have absolutely any doubt in our mind that enteral nutrition is better than parenteral nutrition. So you have around 8 studies here, which has been time and again shown. And even as part of Aspen guidelines, it has been very clearly shown in critically ill patients, enteral nutrition is preferred over parenteral nutrition. I think that, I don't think any of us have any doubt. And it has been shown that enteral nutrition reduces your infection morbidity, so reduces the risk of infection. So all the studies have shown, by feeding them early, you can reduce the risk of infection-related morbidity. It reduces VAP, reduces central line associated bloodstream infections, abdominal abscess. It improves neurological recovery or neurological outcome. Even early enteral nutrition has shown to improve good neurological outcome. And it is shown to reduce the hospital length of stay, reduce the cost, and it is known to reduce non-infective complications. And the mortality rates are similar to parenteral nutrition. So enteral nutrition is the way to go in all critically unwell patients. So because of all these benefits, which has been shown in multiple studies from all countries, literally. So what about trophic feeds? So in critically ill septic patients, where they are hypotensive, where you may not be able to achieve full nutritional targets in 48 hours. So this was a study which came in 2016 by US group. So where they looked at 60 mechanically ventilated patients who were randomized between no enteral nutrition, and this is trophic feeds, where enteral nutrition was restricted to less than 600 kilocalories per day in septic shock patients within 48 hours. They had 37 patients, and this was a group where they gave more than or equal to 600 kilocalories. And what they found is, median length of stay was significantly less in patients who got trophic feeds, less than 600 kilocalories. And even your duration of mechanical ventilation was significantly less in patients who got trophic feeds as opposed to more calories. So what it means, this study highlights, is even in septic shock patients, it is good to start some feeds if not reach your nutrient targets, because they had a more beneficial effects if you restricted your calories. So this raises the debate about underfeeding versus overfeeding. So that's what this study highlights. And mortality, there was no difference between any of these three groups. So the conclusions the author made was, in septic shock, you give enteral nutrition less than 600 kilocalories per day, which is trophic feeds, as compared to no enteral nutrition or enteral nutrition more than 600 kilocalories per day. I think patients who had trophic feeds of less than 600 kilocalories per day had better clinical outcomes. So I think we'll move to the section 2. Choosing the right enteral nutrition formula. Now the question, so we know that enteral nutrition is the way to go. Even if you are not able to achieve full nutritional targets in hemodynamically unstable, our aim is to give at least up to 600 or less than 600 kilocalories, which constitutes trophic feeds, which are some feeding is always better than no feeding. And we know that enteral nutrition has a huge benefit in mitigating all the deleterious outcomes, like reduces the length of stay, reduces duration of ventilation, reduces the infection risk. So now the question is whether we give commercial enteral feeds or non-commercial. When I say non-commercial, it is blenderized type. Blenderized is which comes from the kitchens, from the hospitals. So this was a study which came from Iran group, comparison of energy and nutrient content of commercial and non-commercial enteral nutrition solution. This was a cross-sectional study of 270 patients. So 150 patients got non-commercial enteral nutrition solutions and 120 got commercial enteral. Commercial is where you get it as a powder, so it is reconstituted with water and then administered at the bedside to the patients. So they found that energy intake was significantly less when you use blenderized diet, non-commercial enteral nutrient solutions. And protein intake also was significantly less in non-commercial enteral nutrition as compared to commercial enteral nutrition. And carbohydrate intake also was significantly less compared to commercial enteral nutrition solutions. And fat intake also. So basically all the components, all the nutritional components were significantly less in patients who got blenderized diet or non-commercial enteral nutrition solutions as compared to commercial enteral nutrition solutions. And nutrition adequacy ratio was higher in commercial enteral nutrition solutions. So it goes on to show that the nutrient, the nutritional value or the nutrient components of blenderized diet was significantly falls way below than what you can achieve in commercial enteral nutrition solutions. So now the question should raise, is enteral nutrition which are blenderized is very safe, or if you are reconstituting the commercially available enteral nutrition, is it safe? So can enteral nutrition gets contaminated with microbes? So when you do even commercial enteral nutrition solutions, we reconstitute with water and then use the syringe to deliver the nutrition through the Ryle's tube. So, and these ingredients have a potential to get contaminated during the whole reconstitution process. And the syringes that you use to administer this enteral nutrition also have a potential to get contaminated. And the people, the personnel handling those syringes, I think those hands also can get contaminated. So there are lot of room for all of these things that are utilized in reconstitution that could potentially get contaminated, and the personal hygiene, the type of water you are using or the milk you are using. So all these are a potential for possible contamination that can happen. And it has been found that when you do a open system enteral nutrition, when I say open system, it could be blenderized diet or it could be reconstitution of commercially available enteral nutrition. They have found when you keep them as a standstill, so they can be a potential source for growth of multiple organisms in these solutions. So there is a huge risk of them getting contaminated. So is there any evidence for this? Again, so they did this study with 76 samples and tested for the growth of organisms from the time of preparation. So they tested for those reconstituted diet as soon as they prepared and 18 hours later to see if there was any growth of organisms in the diet that was given. So they took 76 samples and the time of preparation and 18 hours. If you see, the coliform growth happened in 70% at the time of preparation and 87% had more than 10 colony forming units per gram in open system, and staph aureus, 90% grew staph aureus, and after 18 hours that percentage significantly increased to 90% and 95%, and many of them had more than 10 to the power of 2 colony forming units per gram, which means there is a huge potential when you use open systems that the food can get contaminated with these organisms. Whether they are pathological to cause a disease, we do not know, because the colony forming count, colony forming units are still less, which may be present in any food, but it was found that it was significant in open system. And then you need to see whether they are compared with the closed system. So, and what the authors concluded is this blenderized diet or open system do not comply with standard of safety because of these overgrowth of these organisms. And the authors pose a question that there may be a substantial risk for infections or infective contamination in the diet, which may pose a threat to the patients. So now we'll move to the third section, selecting the right enteric formula for critically ill patients. Now the question remains whether we should move towards closed system, considering that open system is prone for contamination with these organisms as shown in the study. So when you look at choice of enteral formula in critically ill patients, so you have four varieties in enteral formula. One is standard polymeric formula. So the standard polymeric enteral nutrition, which we tend to deliver to the patient, would contain essentially these three components. They contain complex carbohydrates, which we all eat anyway. They contain intact proteins and they contain long chain triglycerides. So standard polymeric is for any patients where GI function is normal and where they're able to digest all these naturally administered carbohydrates, proteins. So this is for a patient with a normal GI function who can digest all these carbohydrates and intact proteins and long chain triglycerides. And in blenderized diet, these intact proteins come from basically poultry, pureed meat or eggs. So that's where it comes from. So what about elemental diet? Elemental diet as a substitute to intact proteins, they have individual amino acids. So proteins are broken down to amino acids and is given as elemental diet. And they do not have normal quantities of long chain. They have a very low levels of long chain triglycerides. And the elemental diet is given to patients who have sort of compromised GI dysfunction where they cannot digest long chain triglycerides or intact proteins. So in a little compromised GI, I think elemental diet is preferred. And the key advantage of elemental diet is it produces less load on the pancreas because your pancreatic secretions are not needed because they do not put a burden on pancreas. So it's not associated with overt pancreatic secretions. So that's the advantage of elemental diet. So say, what is the components of semi-elemental diet? Semi-elemental, your proteins are hydrolyzed to oligopeptides, bipeptides or tripeptides. So these constitute the components of semi-elemental diet. And instead of long chain triglycerides, they contain medium chain triglycerides in semi-elemental. And semi-elemental are very easily absorbed from the small intestine. And they have increased jejunal absorption of water and electrolytes, which remain the characteristics of semi-elemental diet. So your small intestine absorption is very rapid because proteins are broken down into these peptides and they have medium chain triglycerides. So then you have this special formula. Special formula is where we give it for certain end diseases like COPD, where you need a low carbohydrate diet, or liver disease or kidney disease, where some of the electrolyte components like potassium content may be little low, or maybe your protein content may be little low. So these are specialized formula reserved for end organ failure of different organs. So choosing the right enteric formula for critically ill patients is, as I said, primarily will be based on GI function. So first you need to ascertain whether GI function is normal or impaired. So if it is normal, I think our intent is to stick to polymeric feeds. So polymeric feeds, the key components is it's isotonic, it has high protein and high energy, and it has fiber. Or if someone has some end organ dysfunction, then you could consider specialized feeds which have some immunomodulatory effect and maybe little low on certain electrolytes. If your gut dysfunction is impaired, then you would consider elemental or semi-elemental diet. And the key difference of semi-elemental is even semi-elemental diets are isotonic. They are high in energy and protein, but they do not have fiber. So that's the difference between the polymeric and semi-elemental. So this is our rough sort of an approach for anyone who intend to feed in ICU. Whether they have, the first question is whether the GI function is normal or abnormal. And then you move on to which diet you are going to consider. So now having decided that, okay, we'll give enteral nutrition. So now we have to dissect out whether open system is better or closed system is better. So we have looked into the background as to open system, how there is a potential risk of them getting contaminated. We'll see if there are any studies to look into it. So the attributes to be considered when choosing enteral nutrition is to obviously limit the infection whilst reconstituting and to make sure that nutritional adequacy is maintained. The most important is considering our labor intensive nursing or the nursing patient ratio, the ease for nurses also is extremely important, because for reconstituting a commercial feed, it does take around 30 to 40 minutes for a nurse. And given our nurse-patient ratio in our country, I think it is extremely important that we ease the burden for nurses, because they may not have that much time at disposal for each patient to spend for reconstituting. So that has also been addressed in certain studies. And the costing. So let's look into the studies. So what are the key differences between open versus closed systems? So when I say closed, it's ready to hang, which is already reconstituted, which is available as a ready-made. You don't have to handle the food. You just have to connect to the Ryle's tube and start feeding. Open is where you have to reconstitute and then aspirate it in syringes and deliver it through the Ryle's tube. So manipulation is minimal in ready to hang. So it is self-intuitive, because in open system, you have to do a lot of reconstitution. So there are a lot of things that you will be using before you administer. And the hang time, I think for open system, it's 4 hours, because every time you have to keep reconstituting, because you cannot store it at once and keep it. So here the hang time has been considered safe for up to 24 to 48 hours. And nursing time is significantly more in open systems as compared to the closed system. And other effects are ease of administration, prolonged hang time, and reduced risk of nosocomial infections, and reduced cost. So what they found from this study from Saudi Arabia is, when you are using open system, it has been found that there can be 20 to 60% of wastage of food, because even though you have reconstituted, you would have delivered around 70 to 80%. So there is a possibility that 20 to 60% of the reconstituted food gets wasted in open system. So the wastage was found to be significant. So considering these things, so the hypothesis the authors may make is, the ready-to-hang feeds may improve the nutritional status of the patient and may improve patient outcome by providing optimal nutrient delivery and reducing the risk of infections. But has this been incorporated in any guidelines? Because now if our whole argument is ready-to-hang, closed system are safer, then does it get included as part of guideline? So this is NICE guideline and the National Clinical Guideline Center. So they quote these two randomized controlled trials where closed system is shown to have lower contamination rates. And the recommendation they make in NICE guideline is, whenever feasible or possible, closed system ready to hang is something that we should consider to be used. So are there any clinical studies to show that closed systems are better than open systems? So that we'll look into this section 4. So this was a study way back. If you see, it is done in 1994 by Wagner et al. So he looked at 88 patients and he looked at the bacterial growth in closed system. As you see, there was 2% growth of bacteria, which was significant, more than 10 to the power of 4 in closed system. But if you looked at the open system, which was decanted from the cans, they found in the final around 60% of them had bacterial growth in 73 patients they looked. And what we use is open system powder. And if you see the contamination, the growth more than 10 to the power of 4, 83% of them had significant bacterial growth. So this was shown way back in this US study in 1994, that closed systems are much safer, because the more handling happens, the potential risk for growth of organism was much higher in the open system. And so this was a very interesting study, which again came from US group Atkins. So they looked at 60 patients where they looked at 562 feeding days. So they had 30 patients with 325 feed days in open system, OS, and 30 patients with closed system with 237 feed days. And they looked at the nutrient delivery. They found that the ordered volume that was received was 74% in open system and it was 84%, which means your nutrient delivery, the wastage was significantly less and your ability to deliver the assigned food was much better in closed system as compared to the open system. So the conclusions the author made was, enteral nutrition with closed system as compared to open system had ability to deliver higher percentage of ordered volume and achieve better nutritional adequacy. And they looked, this was a study by Phillips et al. In 2013, they looked at the cost effectiveness, because one could argue that the open system may be cheaper than the closed system. So here they factored in the extra nursing time and they found when you put a cost for this extra nursing time, it was found to be less cost effective, the open system. So the closed system seemed to fare better than the open system when you factor in the nursing time. If you do not factor, then it appears to us that open systems may be better. But when you factor the nursing time, it was found to be a lot more cost effective. And this was a study by, again, US group, Luther et al., where they found that nursing time, if you see, the 36.6 minutes was the time needed for reconstituting for the open system, and it was 18.6 minutes for closed system because you didn't have to do much. And obviously, the nurses, 87.5% of them preferred closed system because of the ease and convenience as opposed to 12.5. So both were statistically significant. So again, goes on to show that, ready to hang or closed system may be the future in being more cost effective, reducing the risk of infection and optimizing our nutrient delivery better than the open system. So how about in home care? I think home care, it is self-intuitive because in home you need to have a personnel to reconstitute. And this is the checklist in US where they have for home care nutrition, where you need to answer all this checklist. Does the patient have electricity, running water? So I think you're ready to hang liquid nutrition negates this whole checklist, and it becomes obviously more intuitive for us to submit that this becomes much preferred choice, ready to hang. So I think even for home care, better compliance, better data and better results is what really tells us that ready to hang liquid solutions improve compliance in home care by 20%, because you really circumvent the whole checklist there. So the take home message is early initiation of enteral nutrition in critically ill patients definitely is what we comply. It is a quality benchmark for us. Within 48 hours, we need to initiate enteral nutrition. And there are multiple studies, at least 8 to 10 big studies, which have shown that it improves clinical outcome. And non-commercial enteral nutrition feeds are more prone to bacterial. So the blenderized diet definitely is not the way to go. So we should move away from blenderized diet and we should stick to commercially available enteral nutrition. And non-commercial enteral nutrition feeds are more prone for nosocomial infections or food contamination. I think the closed enteral nutrition systems are ready to hang is sterile, and they're easy to handle, and their ability to deliver adequate nutrition is much better. And overall, it improves nutritional status of patients. So thank you very much. So I'll end the talk with this quote: do not give up, the beginning is always the hardest. So I think to get to change our thought to the closed system or to commercially available enteral nutrition takes some effort, but we need to move in that direction. So visit my website www.drpradeeprangappa.com to rehear to this lecture to gain more clarity on this topic. Thank you.